This question is actually based on my personal experience, and I'm sure there's a lot of people in this room, and it is getting worse. But how will you tackle hate crime and harassment experienced by deaf and disabled people in this borough? Because the whole thing around publicity on TV around disabled people is very negative, and as disabled people, we are getting the brunt of that.
Thanks, Denise. Yeah. Very well, mate. I'm going to ask Jonathan to come in first on this one, please.
So, politicians, as well as the media, must share the blame for this.
Yes.
And for too long, a certain group of politicians, and you can make up your own minds about who they were. I know, I'm not going to score party political points, but you'll know yourself. Allowed this kind of division to happen between so-called deserving and undeserving. Yes. And we get this poverty, this license for this poverty porn, you know, which we see in this so-called reality TV that has been feeding the cycle. And then we had the referendum that unleashed another wave of hatred. And it does come from this Conservative government, yes it does, divide and rule policies, which are trying to get us to blame one another rather than the austerity, which we know is behind this. And I'll agree with Jackie on this. There is a wave of austerity which is getting worse and worse, and it's hurting, really, and it's killing people. It is killing people. And we must not let them divide us on that and have this policy of dividing you all. But it's also about politicians standing up and challenging that narrative. And I don't think politicians have challenged it unequivocally on all sides. And I am absolutely resolved with the Green Party to do that. And I believe we have done that. We've challenged it and challenged it in 2015. We were the only ones standing up saying austerity is a lie. Don't let them pursue this divide and rule. I'm very pleased that Labour have come across. And now seem to be moving in the right direction, but there are still politicians who are pursuing that on the Labour side as well. So it's about what comes from the top. It is also about awareness training. So I work a lot with local police, as chair of my ward panel for 3 years, and now vice chair of my ward panel, setting the priorities for local policing. And I kind of tear my hair out sometimes with the lack of awareness amongst police. We know that on public transport there's a lack of awareness about the needs. And it is about making that training and input into professionals absolutely mandatory, that people get it and people receive it. And social services need it as well. And I know it's tough at a time of cuts where we're all really at breaking point and we all feel we've got too much to carry. But this is not something that can be deprioritised. It has to be, its priority needs to be given. And the more we can do that, the better. The last thing is public spaces. It's deaf and disabled people are more and more being pushed out of public spaces. Yeah. So, you know, it's easier therefore to demonise deaf and disabled people where you don't have as much regular contact with them and with the wider community. And this, of course, comes down to things like libraries. And when I see what's happened to our libraries in Lambeth, particularly the Carnegie Library, that is, frankly, is not a library in any meaningful sense of the word anymore, although the council claims it is, in terms of the library services, but the support that was there for the community. And people, that's a lifeline for many people that's been taken away. And more, the deaf and disabled people are pushed out of those public spaces, the harder it's going to be, and that's why we need to fight for our public spaces.
Thank you, Charlie, please.
Obviously, a lot of dealing with hate crime boils down to what the police are willing to do and what the CPS is willing to do. It's very much more a legal system thing. But you can, in terms of, you need to work to change social attitudes, to reduce it, stop it from happening in the first place. We need to be focusing on changing social attitudes. So one of the organisations I work with is the Patchwork Foundation, and they work to get people from underrepresented groups more engaged in public life. Obviously that would include disabled people. We need to see more disabled people running for the council. I'm really pleased that the Lib Dems have, to the best of my knowledge, at least four of our main 12 target candidates are disabled or are unpaid carers themselves, which I'm really pleased about. We have other candidates who are, including my own mother, who is confined to bed as a general rule, is running as a candidate. I used to work in a school, and it did so much to change attitudes. Was the kid allowing kids to see me as an obviously openly disabled person? They asked the questions, we got over it. And their understanding of what it is to be disabled and to be a disabled person was improved. Then you come down to things like increasing local neighbourhoods policies. So that if you are a disabled person who is being made a victim of crime in your own neighbourhood, in your own house, you become a priority for rehousing. That the people who are harassing you in your own home become a priority for being got out of the area. We need to increase things like looking at evictions. If you cannot treat your neighbours with courtesy and respect, you should be asked to move on and find alternative accommodation. And that applies to anyone. I'm really, really hard on people who display such a lack of courtesy, such a lack of respect, such a lack of decent human behaviour that they would target a disabled person, target an elderly person, target a carer in their home, in their community. And Jonathan's right, disabled's pushing people out of public spaces. The Carnegie used to be an accessible building. Now it isn't. Used to be, there's public, local public services, there's a fully accessible gym in West Norwood. But you can't get any support to access it. There's none. I've tried to get involved in the exercise. Like there's exercise programs that are run by the local care commission group that are fundamentally inaccessible. So you have that perception that, you know, we're lazy, we sit at home, la 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 la, we don't do anything. And of course we can't do anything when there's no funding for anything. I went to Lambeth College. I was a student at Lambeth College. There was no funding for my access needs. Yeah. There's no funding for my access needs. How do people learn and see disabled people as normal if we're not allowed to be normal? If we're not allowed to learn and work, to go out at night, to go to the cinema, because we can't get the care hours, because we can't get the support, because we can't get funding for a wheelchair or a mobility scooter. How do we become seen as normal members of society if we're not able to be treated as normal because our council won't let us?
Thank you, Chair. Finally on this one, please check it.
Right. So you were starting off talking about hate crime. Mm-hmm. And that's it's a despicable crime, and it's really important that anybody experiences does report it, even if not much action is taken to start with. But at least the police will start building up a database of where it's happening. So I know it's difficult, and there's people can help with reporting, but it is a difficult thing to do. So the way to tackle it is to try and eliminate it, and it is a lot of it is about awareness raising. And our Equality Commission, we did consult with quite a lot of disabled people, and it was quite a wake-up call, to be fair. And that's just why we did, and that's a subsequent report on disability, just on disability. And and I said before, the key thing is to raise awareness. But I think that most people, it is awareness raising. Particularly, I think of those invisible disabilities. Like people can be quite sympathetic to somebody in a wheelchair because they know what that means. But when they see somebody who may have autism or something like that, they don't quite know how to handle it. Or somebody with mental ill health. They don't quite know how to handle it. So we do need to raise that awareness of frontline staff particularly, but not just them, it's the wider community as well. And we can roll that out.
Is that happening in the local authority?
That's our plans. We're plans for the new... We've got that report agreed on the 18th of March, so the new administration will have a blueprint of what to do. Because if we started all over again, it would take another year or so. So we're determined to get that in. So it should be in place. And there is the Alzheimer's Society have really promoted Dementia Friends very widely. We're looking at some kind of similar model to that, where you roll it out to the whole community so that people can just understand. I think nearly everybody, when they understand, will be much more sympathetic. A lot of it is about ignorance. What else am I going to say about this? And the other thing that came out of the Equality Commission is about this need for leadership. It really is important, as people have said, you do need to have disabled people in leadership positions. We need to have disabled people in senior positions in the council as well, because they have a lot of influence. So these are all things that we need to develop. And now we have got this blueprint. I know it's a blueprint, but it's there, and it's now important we push it through and make sure it happens with the new council.
Thanks, Jackie. What I'm going to do now is, it's been over an hour, tea and coffee out there. Let's say something about the break. We have time, there were three questions there.